Hi, good evening everyone. My name is Pawan Mulukutla and I'm the head of the Integrated Transport Program at World Resources Institute, WRI India. And I'm going to really talk today about the context of Master Plan looking at the transportation and traffic sector. If you really look, I actually have taken a print of the document of the Master Plan, and it is basically the draft volume 3. Revised Master Plan, the traffic and transportation is the 11th chapter, and it really talks about, starts from about for 10-15 pages, starting from page 94. Now, if you really look at, before I get into what are the pros, cons, and what are the great things about the Master Plan and what are not so great things about Master Plan, I think we really have to think when we're talking about our city in the context of two things. One is, what do we really want to achieve and how are we going to achieve? Now, if you really understand, I think Master Plan is actually a very, very great opportunity for us in city like Bangalore, where we really want to bring about a change. If you ask today, I don't think anyone needs to know about what are the issues in transportation. I think even if you ask a school student, we all know that, you know, what are the transportation challenges and issues and what needs to be done. And how does really Master Plan help in this context? Now, one thing you really have to understand is Master Plan is the only statutory document where we actually have some legal binding. So therefore, it really represents an important opportunity for citizens and for all of us. Because, you know, there are many studies that are typically done around transportation. You actually have sometimes studies, something called, you know, CMPs, comprehensive mobility plans. You have CCTPs, which is comprehensive traffic and transportation plans. Then you have CTS, and many cities choose to do. But you know what? It is not mandatory. It is not any. There is no legal binding. It's not a statutory document. The only thing which is statutory, which we can really press and say that this is what we want from our city, is actually the Master Plan document. Now, coming to the basics of transportation, we all know that in Bangalore today, we have about 30% of the way people travel, if you take all trips, is using walking and cycling. Another 30% do using public transport, which is using buses and, of course, the latest addition being metro. And then we have another 20-25% around two-wheelers and cars and auto rickshaws, taxis. So this is like a one-third split is how the modal share is. Now, coming to the document on the traffic and transportation section of the Master Plan itself, what is happening right now? So I was looking, I have gone through this document a couple of times, and when you really look at in terms of identifying the issues of congestion, I think the Master Plan has done an excellent job there. Because for instance, it talks about how there is extreme congestion, how there is trip rate, how the vehicular traffic is 52% on traffic. There is absence of road network hierarchy, which is really one thing that is something you all need to know. So we don't know which roads we need to call as, for instance, arterial roads, which actually connect in the city. We don't know which roads we need to call as sub-arterials or minor arterials and collectors and so on and so forth. And then we also, the Master Plan clearly is identifying that the network congestion hampers bus operations significantly. There is a growing use of personalized vehicles, which we all know. There is deficient multimodal integration. The movement of freight and goods remains a challenge. Non-motorized transport is inadequate. Parking is disorganized. A high car dependency has also added to high air and noise pollution levels. So to this extent, it's great that it's clearly identifying what are the issues that as a resident, as a citizen of Bangalore, that we all are facing. But when we move on, one thing that it really talks about is how did they really come up with something like a plan for understanding the issues of Master Plan. So in that context, it really says that, you know, there was a model that was developed using a particular software, and it was really mapped, and then things were really talked about what's happening in terms of the traffic assignment. But what is the challenge here? Clearly, I am not able to, or any of us don't have any clue of
Of course, where counts have been taken has been shown on a map, but what has not been clearly shown is how is my city performing today, and can really this model be put out in public domain? Because let that information be open and be used to people. If they really want to come up with plans and things that will really work, then we should really solicit feedback from citizens as well. So I would really urge, and it should be one of the things that we need to ask is, can we, instead of just saying that the model really says, for example, I have a chart here which really talks about how the master plan is talking in terms of how my city is really doing, and we really have a map showing like these are all the links where the roads are all congested, which volume is over the capacity. But this really is not enough. So this is some information that we all anyway knew, that in Bangalore all roads are congested. So one thing which we have to be very clear is, can the model be put out in public domain? They have said that they have used Cube Voyager to really talk about it. In terms of forecast scenario, it seems some forecast scenarios have been developed, and it clearly says that doing nothing but believing in metro will not solve Bangalore's problem. Bus frequency would reduce to less than half, even with double the fleet. I think it's a very dangerous thing that we are hearing, and we really need to see what the master plan is going to really do to address this issue. The vehicular trips is going to increase more than 3 times. So we are already talking about 70 lakh plus vehicles. And if we are really going to say that we are going to go by more than 3 times, that's a very dangerous trend. Public transport share is going to reduce substantially. The network speeds are going to drop further. And in some directions, they are talking about speeds less than 5 kilometers per hour. And the pollution levels will increase by 3 times. So we are seeing that it's not a great news in terms of when the forecast scenario is being talked. Heavy dependence on private vehicle usage, heavy impact on health and safety of citizens. And what is missing in the master plan is it really doesn't talk about, we know that in Bangalore more than 800 people die every year due to road accidents. So how is it going to address that? That piece on road safety is also missing. The approach to traffic and transportation has been touched upon by saying that we need to have a major transit station within 3 to 4 kilometers of any part of Bangalore, which is good, with a great, excellent last mile connectivity. Cross-sectional elements of how roads should be designed is listed. How minor bus terminals should be provided has been talked about. Multi-zone utilities have been really talked about. Now coming to the transport strategy. So I'm just going to walk you through this transport in the first half about what the plan is talking about. And then I will really comment on, you know, what's going to work and what's not going to really work. The master plan has kept a strategy that we need to improve the existing road network by developing a network structure and define the road hierarchy, which is a right prioritization. It also talks about a strategy that how do we really move from on public transport from 50% of the trips to about 70% of the trips. And then it talks about bringing about 20 to 25% of people under something called transit-oriented development. I think we all need to understand what is transit-oriented development. Transit-oriented development means that actually around, can your transit hub become centers of mass activity where people live within short distance of a transit node and are able to complete their trip either by walking or cycling or by accessing mass transit for their day-to-day needs. So that's what transit-oriented development means. But perceptionally, it's always seen as that if I just increase something, what is known as FSI or FAR, the floor space index or floor area ratio, that is enough as TOD. No, TOD means do I have access to different amenities? How am I going to make trips? How do I prioritize walking, cycling? How do I really minimize parking within certain areas around transit areas? So TOD has to be seen from a different context and not just really increasing the space in the city. That only happens to be one of the things. And one of the shocking things that the master plan also says that they were assuming that the buses would have increased to 15,000 by 2031. But we all need to understand that Bangalore needs 15,000 buses today. I mean, we cannot wait for another 14 years to really make sure that we actually are going to add and double the service in another 15 years. So I think that's not a good priority that we have identified. There is some mention about the ITS program, the B-track program, in terms of how do we talk about improving the intersections. And it also talks that if we really want to have an effective shift to public transport, we need to manage our demands. See, we cannot solve obesity by, you know, increasing our size of our clothes. We really need to go on a diet also. So if we are really thinking in terms of that perspective, we can't keep building flyovers and we can't keep expanding and widening our road network. We really don't have that kind of an opportunity in Bangalore. So when we are really thinking in from that context, we really have to think of demand management. It talks about it, but it's not very clear in terms of, it does mention parking charges as a tool to really reduce the dependence and reduce the demand on, to curb the demand. And then there is a network that I'm going to really pull to show you all. This is again from the master plan that we are really talking about, that this is the master plan really saying that, you know, these are the different roads that will come around in the city. So if you really see, this is the core area, and then it shows the metro lines, it shows the nice road, the PRR, the STRR, and, you know, it really talks about kind of a regional connectivity in the and around Bangalore. You know, it's really talking about how do you really connect all the areas around in terms of, you know, coming up with wider node network. So which I think is good, but we all also know that PRR was talked about in the last master plan also. So the question is then how do we really achieve in this master plan? So it's good to some kind to understand that a lot of things has been talked about. And if you can see my screen, it really, for the first time, we are seeing that roads have been classified, which says that what are arterial roads and what are major arterial roads. So, and basically it really talks about all the major roads in the city. So which is a good classification that it really is talking about. And then it really talks about a list of public transport systems. So we're talking about 653 kilometers of public transport in different forms. Of course, we already have metro under construction of phase two. It talks about commuter rail system, 106 kilometers. It talks about BRTS, LRT, metro, and along several roads. Now coming to what's working and what will not work. I would really say that when you're thinking about master plan, it has to really look from the perspective of what is it that I want the citizens of my city to really achieve. Can we really have certain standards that, for example, can my overarching goal be, say that if I want a clean air, or if I'm saying that my target is to really have 70% of public transport, people travel on public transport, then the master plan has to really say that how will I really achieve it? Without that, just saying that, okay, we need to do this, we need to do this, we need to do this, becomes a wish list. And with holiday seasons and Christmas around the town, it sounds good, but is it really achievable? Is it possible? Is a big question mark. And it really is a very tough thing if we don't have buy-in. Couple of things that are missing. A, I would really say that the transport sector should say that we need to achieve these 3-4 standards. In terms of like what will be the modal share that I want to achieve, what is the air quality levels that I want to see in the city, what do I really want to see in terms of how do I really reduce my road fatalities in my city, and how do I really achieve these 3-4 things as a safe and livable city. I think people centric has been mentioned, but how do you really achieve people centric plan from transportation perspective should be the overarching umbrella. What I would really also say is, I don't think it is very clear that every department has been in transportation, that I'm only talking about transportation, in transportation sector. For example, is it BMTC, KSRTC, the transport department which gives the permits, and other agencies, the UD and all other departments which actually have PWD, have some or the other role in the transportation. Have their plans been taken into consideration, A? And second thing is, are they really agreeing to follow what the master plan is really saying? So the interdepartmental coordination is key to the success of this master plan. Otherwise, it's a wish list that no one wants to listen to. How do I know that what is being said in master plan as a guideline will be followed by some department? So I think to that extent, we really need to start thinking, how do we really make sure that the master plan really becomes more usable? So I would really strongly say that this has to be really brought down to how this, all these departments can come together and really work. The second thing is, in terms of policy, the Unified Metropolitan Transport Authority as the nodal agency to really achieve has not been talked about in the master plan. And therefore, my fear is that we are going to keep seeing projects in silos. We know that we will see metro construction happening on its own. We will see that some buses of KSRTC or BMTC in the city are going to start coming. We are going to see permits being issued for intermediate transport. We'll see some roads that are being developed. So how do we really ensure that as a city, if we all departments come together and say that we want to achieve this modal share, we want to achieve this air quality, then we will be able to come together and say that, okay, these are the priorities that the city needs to look, and which is that agency which is really going to start thinking about, how do I prioritize my projects? How do I prioritize my funding? I think that's where the key would really lie. The third thing is, which we have a great opportunity, is can the master plan really talk about what kind of street design guidelines needs to be part as a guideline, as you know, really saying that what will really work for us in ensuring that when our cross sections are being designed, we really take for pedestrians, for bus stops, for parking, to ensure that, you know, it's a streets for all design. So we really need to make sure that the street design guidelines become part of the master plan. It becomes a template for public works department, or becomes a template for the municipal corporation. So I think, and we have great examples from tender show that how our intersections should be designed, how our roads needs to be designed. So we really need to think from that perspective. What is missing again? Local area plans are missing. Unless we really have local area plans as part of our master plan, and we start detailing out, we will only see regional connectivity and we are not going to see any neighborhood level improvement. And this is really an opportunity that we really need to get local area plans in place. This is really enables citizens and it empowers that we really see improvements in our neighborhood. You know, I was also thinking little bit from a different perspective, that we all care for city, no doubt. But I think at the end of the day, people are really more concerned about their neighborhoods also equally. So while at a city level, we are saying that we need all this, but if we don't see local area plans in terms of how things are going to come around, it will, I'm afraid that, you know, we'll not get anything really running on the ground. And also moving on in terms of land use and transport integration, unless we look at transport and really integrate it from the perspective of how the land use is, and we see transport as an opportunity for, as an economic opportunity, rather than just thinking that I'm really moving people and goods, but I am providing as a city, moving people to their, giving them more economic opportunity, you know, ability to increase their earnings, and we are able to integrate the land use properly, it will really not work out. And that's where I feel that a better focus on TOD policies, we really have opportunity to really engage with many experts in terms of how TOD policies should be implemented, how it should be monitored, how it should be evaluated. I think that's a very, very big thing that can be achieved. And this is an opportunity how we really think about TOD in our cities. In terms of parking, what is, you all know that under the zonal regulations, which is the mandate of the master plan, parking is one of the major components. And when I'm talking about parking, I'm really talking about, for example, the parking norms will say, okay, please provide one space of parking in terms of looking at per dwelling unit, or it can be one space of whatever, X space, based upon the square feet of the apartment or the size of the buildings. There's different ways different cities do. But if we keep sticking to this norms, have to have same kind of parking throughout the city, I'm afraid that our transit zones and our focus on public transport, we will not be able to develop as high priority zones. We need to make sure that we need in buildings which are going for which start coming up, we really need to start regulating parkings. There is, we always say that we need to provide this much of minimum space of parking for this size of building. We need to reverse the trends around the globe in best practices around the city is to really say, can we actually abolish parkings in certain zones? Like, why can't we think that around every metro station within first 100 or 200 meters, we should have zero parking in any new building that is going to come. And as the redevelopment starts happening, we really need to move away saying that, oh, we need to provide two parking spaces, three parking spaces, because what we are seeing is around these transit stations, you have such high-rise buildings coming up. Two things, it's not affordable housing, A, and B, you have all these buildings which are parkings, and unfortunately, those are not the people who are going to use transit. So it becomes the purpose of having transit gets defeated. So we really need to abolish this whole concept that, oh, I need to have minimum, I need to provide this parking. We really can say that we need to have this whole differential approach to parking. We can look at many models. Many cities have said, okay, this is the maximum you can provide because this is based upon my circulation pattern. This is based upon my road capacity. So I need to move away from providing some minimums. I'll say probably this is maximum. You can, you know, some cities have gone to the extent of saying that for three apartments, probably there's going to be only one parking space. So that's quite an ambitious target, and that's how we need to start thinking. Also, can we really not force people who are buying apartments to also have them buy space? So can we unbundle parking from our apartment buying? Because what is happening is we pay lakhs and lakhs for even getting a parking space. If you see that we don't really think about buying new parking spaces, then, I mean, if we don't really care about owning a parking space, then why should I really pay for it? So I think we, if in this regulations, if there's an option where you say that, you know, parking becomes like an option to buy, and, you know, people can then choose what they want to do, it really happens. And, you know, many cities around the globe are really unbundling parking from their buying the dwelling units. So definitely it's a very, very big opportunity, because parking is a major component of regulations, and we really need to ensure parking, because parking is invites a lot more vehicles on streets. It really gives a feeling that, you know, I will find a spot, and so I'll start driving my private vehicles. And I think this whole notion that multi-level car parking should be built, we need to really move away from that. Around transit, the focus of agencies should be more on building better infrastructure, like better footpaths, and, you know, providing more information, integrating different services, rather than thinking that, oh, how do I really care for using high property of my city to really build parking lots. So these are some thoughts which I would really say that master plan has to really look. It has to be a little more in terms of goal oriented. It really needs to have service level benchmarks. For instance, we all know that, you know, there will be some guidelines to say for every 1,000 population, there should be 0.8 or one bus. So we really need to start thinking that, can my systems be more service oriented? So then it really starts setting this benchmark that, okay, you need to have this much of public transport if you really want to achieve this kind of modal share. Because to just say that, oh, we will achieve 15,000 buses 15 years later is really like inviting a big problem. So we are really kind of shelving off the problem to future and not really addressing what we want to do right now. One more thing, a big time missing is around bike sharing systems. and how do we really encourage public bike sharing systems that is being discussed upon. And so we need to talk about, we need to design a street for pedestrians, and those street design guidelines should become part of the master plan. At least it will serve as a template. We also really need to ensure that UMTA, the Unified Metro Transport Transit or Transportation Authority, is really the nodal agency for guiding transportation in the city. We need to be target oriented. We need to have service level benchmarks. And I would really say that really prioritize hierarchy of roads can be better worked. We are really talking about hierarchy of roads right now only in terms of major roads, but there is an opportunity to really define it a little more better. And I would really say, how do we ensure that whatever the master plan is really talking about in terms of, you know, that this agencies and that agencies will really work on. And in the appendix, it really talks about towards the end, please refer to the master plan, that which agency is responsible for which project. Many of them are listed for GOK, which is very obvious. But I would really say that unless there is interdepartmental buy-in, that this is what the master plan is reflected, and it's a vice versa, that this is what it needs to go. And then there is budgets that are going to be allocated. There is over the next couple of years, we would really truly achieve to some extent what we are setting, some of this ambitious, but much, much needed for our city to thrive and survive and make it a place for which is livable, which has happiness index, which really makes sure that the quality of citizens is better, would only be a dream. So I'm really hoping that some of these inputs are considered. And I really thank B.PAC and Citizen Matters and others for, you know, facilitating this platform to express and bring about views from different sectors. If you have any questions or if you really have any comments, please really tag on Twitter or Facebook, one of the handles of B.PAC or Citizens Matters, and really reach out to them. Your inputs are really valuable, and I hope that we are able to empower and make sure that our citizens are more well-informed. And of course, one thing that I really forgot when I was saying in my list is local area plans, because that is what really comes down to what we see on ground, becomes an integrated element of master plan. With that, I would like to really conclude this discussion. Thank you everyone for attending, and it was really and it's really great that we are having this discourse in our city.